Good morning, everyone, and thank you for joining us on today's live webinar. My name is Nancy Youssef, and I'm the founder of Classic Finance and Classic Mentoring. Over the last two decades, I've worked in this industry as a broker, a mentor, recently an author and speaker. I'm very excited to be here today with you and with Prosper, as today's topic is one that I'm very, very passionate about. Today is a little bit more about than just about diversification. Although diversification is the buzzword at present, today's session is really going to be more about understanding the future of small business funding, where that's headed, and identifying opportunities and equipping you with knowledge to identify opportunities to help your small business clients. Most importantly, the angle that we'll be taking today is really looking at ways to avoid tying up your clients' personal assets and funds in use with business purposes. Now, we all know that diversification is important for retention. It's important to remain relevant in the industry. And most importantly, it's important because the more products that your clients have with you, the stickier they are likely to be. And so protecting your trail book is something that we're all very passionate about. Now, before we kick off, I'd like to share with you some facts. Currently in Australia, there are 2.3 million businesses, small businesses, which employ 44% of the private sector workforce. And from that, they are contributing to about 35% of our GDP. Now, we do know that 60% of loans, residential loans, are being written through the broker channel. However, only 20% of small business and commercial loans are being written through the broker channel. Now, to me, there's an obvious opportunity here, and that is something that I'm excited to be unpacking with our panelists here today. So to kick off today's session, I'm proud to introduce you to our esteemed panelists, who not only bring with them a wealth of experience, but also have successfully been able to navigate and work in tandem the broker and accountant relationship, not only to provide solutions for their clients, but to help them improve their overall businesses and the foundations of where they're trying to achieve with not only lifestyle goals, but their business goals as well. So introducing first up, we've got Anthony Landell from Equilibria Finance. That's my human bit coming through. Justin Mastouris from the Reese Group. Davey Mash, who's running Box Advisory Services. Yes. And Alex Brudigat, from the head of Prosper Partnership. So thank you for joining us today with our panel.
Thanks, Nancy.
We are doing some polls as we go through each question today, and those polls will be coming up on your screen. So we do encourage you to answer those as we progress through today's session. So to kick off our panel, Anthony, we talk about how can business funding be structured, and we sort of talk about the notion of, using a mortgage is much cheaper and it's a lot easier to structure, loans for business use. So can you give us some context around that and why that potentially may not be the best way to go?
Yeah, sure, Nancy. Thanks for that. I guess in the environment we're in today, to step back, traditionally a lot of business funding and business finance, irrespective of the specific needs of the business, has been done through either tying up equity in the home, maybe using a personal credit card, or setting up a line of credit against your home. What we've seen over the last 5, 10, 15 years is an evolution in small business finance. There's a lot more options out there to structure the finance to reflect the actual needs of the business. So the approach from a broking perspective is to, with all those options in the marketplace now, is to firstly actually understand the needs of the business. Is it for cash flow finance? Is it for working capital requirements? Is it to fund the growth of the business and the expansion of the business through increased requirements around stock or product? Is it to buy commercial premises, or is it managing terms of trade? So the first point is to actually understand the needs of the business. The second point is then to actually now get the finance structured to reflect those needs, because there's a lot of different products, opportunities to specifically reflect the needs of the business now that may not specifically or may not need to tie up the equity in the home. Some of the considerations around that are including how quickly do you actually need the funds? What are your terms of trade, the strength of your balance sheet? How long have you been in business? Do you in fact have tax debts? There's options out there where business might have a structured tax repayment plan, but you can still get business funding now.
And Davey, I see that you're sort of nodding with that around the tax bit. Do you want to sort of give us a little bit of context around that?
So generally, with small businesses, they normally used to go to the banks and they always have to have the lodgement of tax returns. Mm-hmm. Look at the ATO debt, but now that there's more small business lending out there, you know, you can bypass most of those and they look at your bank statements. You probably would have more knowledge of that, where you can actually look at just your bank statements for the last six months. They may look at your ATO debt. Sometimes they don't even mind with the ATO debt, so I totally agree.
I guess, Anthony, you've, you know, seeing this every day and dealing with this kind of thing every day, you know, brokers love a real-life example or a real-life story. So do you mind sharing with our audience potentially a real-life example?
Yeah. So I guess the only other point I'd make there, which is coming to the example, is how do you actually secure the debt? Traditionally, it's been with equity in the home, but there are other options now. You can use the... You can use the ledger book, you can use the bank statements, you can use the asset that's being acquired. So there are other options about securing the debt, and a lot of that revolves around the usage of the funding. So an example I had recently was a small business had used equity in their home to essentially fund monthly requirement to pay salaries if they needed a cash flow requirement, as well as actually funding the purchase of stock because of the supply terms of trade they'd negotiated. So we looked at that business, sat down with their accountant, sat down with the business owner. We restructured that to remove any of the finance being secured against the home, and we put in place a facilities that actually reflected their needs.
Yep.
So we established a line of credit that they could draw on and use once a month if they required it. So they're actually only making repayments based on usage.
On only what they're using, yes.
And the second thing we put in place for them was invoice finance to manage the supplier, to manage the payments to their suppliers. So they were able to get their funds earlier to then buy more stock and grow the business. So it was sitting down, rather than having a lump sum that had been drawn against their home, sitting down and looking at their requirements and then structuring some funding around those specific requirements and getting the right product in place that actually gave a better return on investment than having a lump sum sitting against
your property. And I guess, Alex, looking at that, I mean, you know, you predominantly are offering a service where there's no security, really. What are your thoughts around that?
So our experience has been, and driven off the back of our joint CEOs and founders who were small business owners in their own right, I'm yet to meet a small business owner who isn't reactive. I'm sure you guys will attest to it. You know, you need financials or they need something from you and they need it yesterday. They need access to finance and it's yesterday. So we've really embraced that and embraced technology as well to look at finance very, very differently in the way we assess risk and assess the health of a business and not the business owner. Because we understand that small businesses out there are looking for access to funds, but they're looking for speed and service before anything else. So, it's something that we look at, you know, in terms of assessing bank statements as well as a number of other things.
So you're not just relying on the security. I mean, there's obviously a lot of other factors that you're looking at when you're, you know, making a decision around these loans. So
Well, that's what makes us a fintech. I mean, we think of ourselves as a finance company, but our technology looks at over 450 data points in 15 seconds.
Yeah,
well, that's just
huge.
Insane.
It's
all to enable getting access to funds. So we want to understand everything about the business, not just what the financials say or that they have security to offer, but rather giving them alternative options to funding so that they can realise their dreams and potential as a small business owner.
Absolutely. No, that's fabulous. Thank you. Now, Davey, you've been working in this space for over 12 years. And you're very, very passionate about not only helping your clients, which are predominantly self-employed, achieve their business goals, but you've got a quite a unique sort of focus on also their lifestyle goals.
Yes.
So you're quite passionate about that. Now, can you share with us, I guess, some of your insights on how you've used business funding to not only facilitate cash flow,
mm-hmm.
but also business growth? And we sort of talk about that being reactive versus proactive.
Yeah. So generally, there's two types of funding that most businesses usually go for. And it really depends on their life's cycle. So mm-hmm. usually there's an upturn, there's a downturn. Downturn, most of the time, they look for reactive funding, where reactive is more like when they're trying to solve a problem when they're currently having with their business, which is cash flow,
mm-hmm.
The machinery that's broken down, so they try to get funding in terms of that. Where it's proactive, for example, my business right now, we've gone on to our third year, and right now we're trying to hire and find the right staff to grow our business. So therefore, we've actually went and looked for funding to hire those right people, because right now we don't have the fund to grow our business. We've reached a state where we've pretty much plateaued.
Mm.
The reason why we've plateaued is because we don't have the funding to grow our business.
Mm.
So we realize that because I'm an accounting business and we rely heavily on our labor as well as our expertise, we need to hire the right people. So that being proactive about it, we've went to funding and we've asked for funding for our small business, and we've been able to...
As in your personal business, as in Vox Advisory?
Okay. Yes,
okay,
yes.
Great, okay.
Yeah, so we've... And we are pretty much... We didn't want to go and put our asset and our security into that.
Which can be quite complicated when you've got more than one director, right? You know, in a business, and the funds are being used for business purposes. Not every
guarantees, all those sorts
of things. So you would have seen that too, Justin. There's a lot of directors that have resistance around, you know, securing their own personal assets for the use of the business.
And the worst part is that when you start switching accountants, and because, let's face it, we do switch accountants now and then, it's hard to transfer that information and that pass over to the new accountant. And normally, and I've had this case where before, where a previous accountant wasn't claiming the tax deductions on the refinance they pulled out of their home for their business. So they want to claim...
So they'd be losing a lot of that tax deductibility.
Yeah, and we worked it out that it was roughly around $20,000 in tax refund that they could have got.
Significant.
Yeah.
And Alex, I guess, you know, looking at that again, I like to sort of pick on Alex here because he's on the other side. And he's threatening that I get no lunch today, so I'm watching you. I guess, you know, further to Davey's point around that with, you know, being sort of where a business needs to be more, proactive as opposed to reactive. What are your thoughts on that?
Yeah, it's amazing. Even in our experience, we have a lot of customers who come to us initially because they're reactive. And once they go through the process and realise how simple and easy it is to get access to funding, they often come back to us. In fact, over 67% of them come back to us. That's our repeat rate because they want to realise an opportunity, and that's what got them started straight away. So that's where I get really excited. When they started their business, whenever it was, they had this dream, and then they hit a roadblock because they couldn't realise their dream because they've either used up all their equity in their home to get the business going, and now they need access to funds, but traditional lending simply can't help them. So for us to give them access to get more staff or stock or whatever it is, new fit out, extension, to take their business to another level, it's pretty exciting stuff.
Mm-hmm. Now, we've put a polling question out to our audience just on this section, so you'll see that popping up on your screens. If you'd like to answer that, we're sort of collating that data, so you'd really help us out by doing that. So thank you for answering that poll question. Okay, as we move through, I'd like to call on Justin, actually. The next thing that I'd like to talk to you about is intertwining personal and business debt. Now, you started with Rees Group in the 90s.
Young boy.
You went there and you did work experience. You had such an amazing time that you didn't leave. And you're still there a couple of decades 20 later.
20-something years later,
yeah.
Yes.
So, great journey. Now, your main clientele with Rees are SME clients also. I guess for our audience, and something that we like to sort of look at is, can you shed some light on some of the common funding traps in actually intertwining business and personal debt, and what some of the considerations that we need to think about there?
Yeah, okay. Well, I suppose business, well, small business owners, and you were saying before, people start off with a dream or they buy into a dream, and you take risks. So people take risks in business. And I think one of the main traps is the people saying, well, what we'll do is we'll put the house on the line and we'll redraw on a facility, but don't actually sit back and look at, well, what's the best path and planning path for what we need to do and how we're meant to actually grow this business in the future. So traditionally, people have gone to look at their mortgage and said, yeah, we'll redraw on the mortgage rather than looking at what's best for the business at that particular point in time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I want to add, for us accountants, we want to reduce our risk as much as possible. And sometimes putting in your equity or putting in your security or your property is probably not the right thing to do for the family as well. So that's something.
And I mean, I know that we say that from a structuring, but is there a deeper layer to that, like as to why it's not the best way to go? What are some of the risks around that, I guess?
Well, definitely, like losing your family home is a really big risk, especially when you have young kids or you have a family to look after.
And how common is it to find that business owners do come to you and they've actually maximised? They can't go any further.
Yeah, it happens.
Particularly when there's lower valuations and those sorts of things. So, you know, what happens then?
Yeah, and the worst part is that the loans, the banks can actually be recalling that loan on them too. So normally what happens after that is that they go to second-tier lenders and they go for interest rate that's a lot higher, as well as the application fees can go through the roof.
Well,
just on that point, I think sometimes business owners don't know that there's other options, I suppose. And we have a broker that works in our office in Melbourne, and being able to have a broker and an accountant sit down with a client and look at other options and say, okay, are you maxed out on your 80% LVR on your property? What are some of the other cash flow funding options? Anthony, you mentioned before, you know, whether it's a debtor's book or if there's some fit-out finance or other finance that's required. So I think it's that sitting down and being proactive.
Yeah, I think that's a key point because traditionally if you start a business or you need your funds, you got an asset sitting there that you say, okay, I'll draw 100 grand or 200 grand or 300 grand to seed the business. Yeah. Whereas now, whatever part of that business cycle you're in, there actually are funding options out there. It's just making sure they fit the business model, whether you're starting up, whether you've got 6 months trading history, whether you're carrying tax debt. There are actually options and opportunities there to fund the startup, the growth and the different cycles within your business that may be able to leave the home out of the picture.
It's up to us as well to educate our clients and let the clients know and speak to the mortgage brokers or speak to the brokers and speak to the accountants to let the clients know that there are different options out there that we can take or they can possibly take as well.
So we talk about the advent of alternative lending in the marketplace, right? And that's where Prosper comes in. 7 years ago, before us, it didn't exist. But there are so many options now. But what's scary is to think, and I was going to then jump onto education and awareness. Only 5 years ago, awareness for alternative lending was very, very low. In fact, consideration for alternative lending was only 4% 5 years ago. Now, wind the clock forward to today, awareness has increased to over, I think it's around 68% of alternative lending. And that's just not Prosper. That's all sorts of stuff, invoice finance, factory, like the heaps of stuff out there. And yet consideration for alternative lending is only sitting at 26%.
But why do you think that is, Alex?
So it talks to education awareness.
Yes.
So people are hearing about stuff. There's a bit of noisy market, but we sort of deal conditioned the marketplace or customers, I'll say, in general, be it PAYG or self-employed, doesn't matter. This is what you need to access money. You need a house, you need equity, you need a stable job, you need to, you know, some sort of security in your business. You need financials that show you can afford debt. So there's all these sort of traditional mindsets that we have in terms of what we need to secure finance. Whereas that landscape has changed dramatically.
I think as well on that is, if you think about the life of a small business owner, they're essentially running their business, whatever that might be, a coffee shop, an accounting practice, whatever their small business is, a building firm, and their focus is on running their business. Yeah. They might not be aware of a lot of the different funding opportunities. So from a broker's perspective, part of our role is to actually get out there and educate the accountants, the advisors that we work with about some of the different solutions that are in place. for their small business clients who come in, sit down, look at their financials, look at their growth strategy, how are they going to manage that growth and how are they going to fund that growth or fund their working capital requirements, and looking at some of the different options around that that may not involve tying up the equity in the home. So yeah. Part of it comes back to us educating those accountants and advisors that we work with as well, who are seeing those SME clients every week.
Mm. Now, we spoke about the fact that 60% of residential loans are being written through brokers. And we see a huge opportunity because the 20% of the commercial and business loans are only being written through brokers. What advice, I guess, you know, just without digressing too far, can we be giving to brokers today around just, you know, spotting some of those opportunities?
I'm happy to give a crack. Yeah. So brokers are a big part of our distribution, as are accountants equally in terms of referral partnerships that exist out there. In simplistic terms, I would say just have a chat with your small business customers.
I say that
because we often, and I see mortgage brokers talk about self-employed customers. Mm-hmm. Not small business owners.
Yeah.
They're very different because they're thinking about them, how they're categorised in terms of servicing. Mm. Are they PAYG or self-employed?
Yeah.
Do I need payslips or do I need financials? Mm. Mm-hmm. Whereas I'm saying, no, they're small business owners. In fact, most of our distribution partners are small business owners themselves.
Yes.
So they're self-employed. So we just say, have a chat, and it's amazing what you'll find out. You know, if they say, I've got to put on an extra staff member, you've put on five in 12 months.
Yeah.
Wow, what's growing your business? Where are you looking to take it? Mm-hmm. And it's amazing how much people want to talk about themselves.
Yeah, now, I mean, I guess with accountants, you know, you have the opportunity to talk to your clients, you know, a couple of times a year, particularly at least once.
Yes.
What about the brokers that maybe are not having those conversations off us? And maybe, Anthony, I might pose that to you.
Yeah, I think from a broker's perspective, if you're looking at getting in commercial finance or you're building in commercial finance, it does come back to the broker to invest in educating themselves as well. Understand what are you looking for in terms of on the financial statements, the P&L, the balance sheet, what are some of the key ratios? How do you actually understand payment cycles in terms of trade, where the cash flow shortages might be in their business cycle? So you really need to take it upon yourself to educate yourself not only in interpreting business financials and then taking that back in terms of understanding their needs, as well as then what are the different solutions in the marketplace, whether it's cash flow lending, invoice finance, term debt, asset finance, and really understanding how those solutions would apply to specific businesses. Because every business is different. Mm. Every business has different challenges. Every balance sheet's different. Every profit and loss statement's different. And every business owner's goals and objectives are different as well. So it's upon the broker to educate themselves in understanding and interpreting financial statements, and then understanding what are the different options in the market to assist those businesses with their strategy.
Yeah. Now, Justin, if I can come back to you, I suppose we started this and we've kind of digressed a little, but I'll bring it back in terms of understanding, you know, the benefits of separating that finance, you know, the personal debt and the business debt. Have you got some examples that you can share with us?
Yeah, absolutely. I think I'll start off just before the example by saying quite often people will look and discuss with an accountant or a broker about the fact that they might need some finance in their business. And the first thing people start talking about, and it's all over the front of the papers every day, is rate.
Mm-hmm.
Right? I think you've got to take it back a step, and you were saying before, is asking the questions, actually digging down to see, you know, what are the requirements for the business in the future? And what are the needs ongoing to grow the business, whether it's staff or other related, as we mentioned before. So an example that we have is a client last year in the fitness industry. They had a first mortgage, they had a house, and they were working with our broker, and they were talking about redrawing on their home loan. And because the broker, ourselves, and the client were all sitting in the room together, so it was that sort of three-way collaboration, we're able to work through what the money was required for and actually sit back and say, well, hold on a minute, there's some other options here. Rather than you redrawing on your home loan, obviously creating a separate deductible loan for that, but rather than doing that, what are some of the other options? And the option we came up with was a cash flow lending option, and this client, I think it was $75,000, was able to draw $75,000 and over a period of 12 months has paid that back. But what it's allowed is allowed them in that particular case, they're expanding their particular fitness operation.
Mm-hmm.
And it meant that they weren't any more encumbered to their first mortgage bank.
Mm-hmm.
And the client was over the moon because of that solution. They didn't realise they could do it.
They could,
yeah.
Now, we've got a question just coming in from the audience, Justin, for you. And it's sort of saying, why the person's asking, why is separating debt more tax effective from an ATO crackdowns, tax deductibility and those sorts of things?
Okay. I'll try and keep this brief.
Yep.
And
you might want to put a disclaimer on that as well.
Yeah, I'll put a disclaimer. Yeah. So many years ago, there was a lot of advice out there about being able to split up your home loan into five different sections and pay into one and redraw off the other. The reality is now that the tax office had a ruling out 2000/2 for some time, and it's all about the nexus of the borrowing of the money, and then also to then where it's spent, and the link to the assessable earning of income. So, just redrawing on a home loan doesn't necessarily mean you're going to get a tax deduction for that money. It's where the money is actually used. So the ATO's crackdown on it, the audit review program the ATO going through has increased significantly. Mm. So coming back to how is it more tax effective, it's the breakdown of the facilities and being able to clearly identify, and Davey, you'd see it, every single month we're getting questions from the ATO for all walks of life, all sorts of clients, which is great, but it's just being able to clearly identify where those deductions are for that facility, facility fees, interest and related, rather than sort of it being intermingled within a personal home loan.
Yeah.
I think another example separate to the deductible, you go finish on the deductible.
Oh yeah, I was going to say that. I had a client that, like I said, they moved over to my accounting firm and they had massive issues with trying to identify what was tax deductible in their home loan that they redrew out.
Mm-hmm.
And the end result was that they couldn't get that information because they focused on their business, they're trying to run their business, and they just said, stuff it, can't work it out, so there's no point in claiming it. And with the ATO, as Justin mentioned, is that they're very stringent on what evidence do you need to provide to tax deduct that interest.
Mm-hmm.
So at the end result, it just caused the problem where they couldn't claim that tax deduction because they just didn't have any evidence.
Yes.
Yeah.
Now, back to Justin, we talk about funding traps and we talk about a business being able to build its own history in terms of, demonstrated, performance and those sorts of things.
Yeah.
Can you elaborate a little bit more about those funding traps just so that our audience is a little bit more across that?
So with a lot of the credit score reporting that's been happening for individuals, and that's all ramped up as brokers, what's been happening there. I think people sometimes forget as advisors, as brokers or accountants that at the end of the day, if someone's been in business for 3, 4, 5 years, it's really important to build up a history of the business being able to trade profitably, but also to potentially, whether it's fit out or cash flow funding, be able to manage its own debt and establish a credit history for that business. Because there's no use running business for 10 years, redrawing on your $2 million property in a capital city in Australia, and then actually getting to a stage where you want to acquire another business or do something that's just the next level, and then all of a sudden the bank and financier is going to say to you, well, why? Well, you've got no history with this. You've been using your personal, essentially personal money to fund this business. So the trap is not to think back to that sort of small-minded, I'm just going to keep drawing on the home loan. Actually look at, well, what does the business need going forward and what sort of facilities can be put in place?
And more so to what, Anthony, you mentioned earlier across the different types of products that are out there to fund that business. So, if you don't have any demonstrated history, with trade finance, then obviously obtaining your first one's always going to be just that little bit more difficult.
Yeah, spot on.
Now, Alex, did you have anything more that you wanted to add to small business funding?
I think talking to, it's great to have these guys on panel because they're the experts when it comes to those sort of implications. But I think when we go back to speed, not tying up an asset, and when for most people they'll understand what that entails. Mm. It's a process which can take weeks,
months.
Yes,
big kind. But I think that it just goes back to looking at what other options are there, which I know you're going to jump into before Anthony. Just off the back of these guys. So I would actually like to hear what your thoughts are on that.
Yeah, I think a couple of key elements to that are building up that business credit history is really important. Mm. I mentioned it before, a lot of it is around making sure the finance actually reflects the business need, whether it's invoice finance, asset finance. For example, you use a lump sum from your home to buy your business assets. The usage of that funding doesn't reflect the depreciation of that asset, for example, doesn't reflect that asset's productivity for the business. You're just using that with a lump sum rather than actually structuring the finance around a specific asset's its productivity and its rate of depreciation. But I guess a couple of key considerations for business owners is how quickly do they need the funds, which is to your point, to access them. It may be more beneficial for a business to get access to funds that, sure, it may come with a slightly higher interest rate, but they get access to those funds 90 days before than they may be able to get a term facility, which then enables them to pay their suppliers, buy more stock, and grow their business. Critical in that is, and I know a lot of these providers now offer this type of calculators, is understanding the return on investment. Because it's not always about the rate. It might be about the usage of the funds. Those funds may only need to be drawn 2 days a month. Those funds may be for a specific purpose. So it's really understanding the usage. It's understanding the opportunity cost of using up equity. A small business owner might want to down the track buy an investment property or use those funds for more personal use. So what's the opportunity or cost of using up the equity? But also that return on investment is critical, whether you're looking at an asset, whether you're looking at the growth in the business. Okay, if I get this $100,000 facility in place, I can buy another $100,000 in stock. That's going to bring in another $300,000 or whatever in revenue. I can pay that facility down and we're left with, you know, $50,000, $60,000, $70,000 in profit to grow the business the next level again. So that return on investment is critical to making these decisions around the type of funding options you should use, as well as, which I've mentioned a few times, making sure the finance structure in place actually is reflective of the business needs. And you had that example before of a client requiring invoice financing, I think you said, to manage their terms of trade, essentially, as distinct from just drawing a lump sum to pay their suppliers. You've actually got a structured product in place to manage your terms of trade and to grow your business. So it's looking at those sort of aspects.
Yeah.
And usage is critical as well. If you're drawing the funds down on day one, or do you need them once or twice a month? And what do the repayments look like in that sort of situation as well?
And what a perfect segue now, because we talk about opportunity costs and a lot of people talk about that. And then I love hearing the story. So why do you need the money? Tell me a bit about your business. And we were talking a bit about that earlier. But what's the cost of doing nothing? Also, so it's not just the opportunity cost. What does it mean if you actually don't, you know, seize the moment or achieve this outcome? What does that mean to your business? And it's amazing. Like we've serviced over 20,000 small business owners now, I have countless examples where people just need the money for 90 days.
Yeah.
And it's not even about then, we don't talk great. They understand what their problem is. They have a very strong exit strategy or they want to have an opportunity that's too good to refuse, but they need the working capital to realise it, which then could propel their business to the next level. But they'll clear it in 3 months.
Yeah, I have a good example of this. I have a client that used to work in a PIYG, used to work for his boss, and what they said to him is that, look, you're doing such a good job, why don't you just set up a company, incorporate, and we'll start working with you and you can build your business. And he said, that's all fine, but the thing is, he needed to get a loan later to buy the equipment and he couldn't get the funding. So he worked for 6 months and he wanted to grow his business and he needed the funding. And when you normally go to traditional banks, what happens? They don't want to talk to you for the next 2 years until you've already...
2 years, and there's a lot of startups too that don't have property.
Yeah.
And so, there's more and more entrepreneurship. There's a lot of, new business owners coming into the business world at a younger age, and many of them have not had the chance yet to acquire property. So what then happens when they do go to a traditional lender, even for a $20,000 facility, and they can't, obtain the finance, they're forced then to use their credit cards or a personal loan. But that just then sets up a pattern of, you know, falling into these funding traps that we're talking about earlier with personal debt.
Yeah.
And also, too, you know, borrowing money from family is not necessarily the right option, because we talked about that business credit history before.
Mm-hmm.
You might do it once or twice, but when it comes to the crunch and you really need the money for an expansion or whatever it is, the financier is going to look at you and say, well, where's the history of this business? You know, you can't just borrow money from mum and dad. That's not a real solution.
It's also good to build the relationship with your broker or Prosper as well. And because you've worked with them before, they know your financials, it's a lot more quicker if they have that information already.
Okay, so we're going to call on our next poll now, so that should be coming up on your screens shortly. And a reminder also, if you've got any questions, we are collecting those from the audience. And we will be answering those, as many as we can get through, possibly, at the end of this webinar. So feel free to shoot those through. But right now, there should be a polling question that should have come up on your screen. So please take some time to answer it. We'd love that data. It's all about data, isn't it, Alex?
It is.
We had this conversation. So, Anthony, you've brought a lot of insight, as the rest of our panelists have done today, and. One thing that I'm very curious about is we talk about, and I've met with business clients myself who've come in and said, oh, look, you know, if I want to get a business loan, that rate is way too high. I'd rather just, you know, use my own property. You know, mortgage rates are sitting at 4.5% at the moment. It's a lot cheaper. And I know you touched a little bit on this around the opportunity costs and things like that. But can you give us a little bit more insight into, I guess, the misconception around the true cost of using personal funding as opposed to business funding?
Yeah, look, I think we touched on it before. A lot of it comes back to...
And we take into account things like LMI and the term of the loan and those sorts of things.
There's those sort of elements. Yeah. Often the term of the loan, if you're drawing equity from your home, won't actually reflect the business need, whether it's for short-term finance or whatever. So I sort of touched on it before around... What's the finance actually for in the business? If it actually is a term debt, where you want a 30-year term loan for purchase of a commercial premises, that's a different proposition to a small business that has an opportunity. They need to fund the stock to get on the shelves to grow the business, and the usage of that funding is maybe for 90 days, or they need to smooth out cash flow across their business cycle to either pay salaries or to fund suppliers. So a lot of it comes down to, so interest rate is obviously part of it. That's the cost of the funding. But a lot of it is actually looking at as well the return on the investment. So Alex mentioned that point before. What's the cost of not having that funding in the first 90 days if the opportunity is sitting there? From a business perspective, what's the benefit, I should probably put it better, of actually managing your asset finance around the depreciation of the asset, the renewal of the asset, the working life of the asset, as distinct from having it sitting out here in a lump sum over a 10, 15, 20, 30-year loan term. So it's looking at each of the individual areas of the business and getting the funding in place to satisfy that. Term debt sometimes is the right solution. But there's a lot of other options there that are now more reflective of the finance, more reflective of the business needs and the usage of those funds. You might have $100,000 sitting there and draw on it twice a month, rather than $100,000 drawn in equity against your home sitting there as part of a debt. So it's understanding those needs.
Just
of the
on term, just a comment I make there. Small businesses, I think we've probably seen, is that they start off with great intentions of, I just need $100,000 worth of funding. I'll draw down on my home loan. Now their home loan's got 26 years left to run. And the reality is that loan might get repaid within the 12 or 18 months that it probably should be.
Yep.
And they'll find an excuse or a reason to use that money elsewhere. So then linking that to what we were talking about before about that business credit history. Again, coming back to it, you're better off paying off a loan, showing a financier that you have the ability in your business to do that, rather than just the easier option sometimes drawing down the home loan, but you've still got that home loan debt and you paid interest on it the whole way
And especially if you haven't had an accountant who's been deducting some of that as well, that adds to the mix of the trap that you're actually in.
Yeah.
I guess, do you have a practical example you can share with us, Anthony?
Yeah, I do. Last point I'd add on that, from a brokering perspective and accounting perspective, with the small business owner, it's up to us as well to show them the return on the investment or the benefit using a particular type of funding. And I think, Justin, you had an example before of showing that to a client. They said, let's draw some equity. Hold on. This actually makes more sense for you as a business owner, and it's actually reflective of your needs to
In that example, I actually recently saw that client, and now they're using that equity to buy an investment property. So yeah, instead of tying up the equity into the business, they're let's create a look at our wealth and some of our goals that we have as a family and use that equity for creating assets.
And I mean, even from a lifestyle perspective, I think, Davey, you sort of talk a lot about the focus you've got around the lifestyle goals. How often do you actually see, I mean, we know that the smart thing from a tax perspective is to have the principal place of residence paid off because there's no tax deductibility there. But if you've got a lot of business debt secured by that family home, do you ever really, you know, how often do you actually see that paid right down?
Yeah, that's a thing.
Really?
Yeah.
or Justin even, I mean, you know, that's, you know, something that you'd come across.
And being a small business owner, like Justin said, that, you know, businesses always tend to go back to funding or try to grow their business or try to do something else with their business, whether it's investments or the business funding. And yeah, generally, they even if they pay it off, they would eventually start borrowing money again. That's just how it works.
Now, Justin, you see this a lot too with broker businesses themselves. And this is something I want to touch on. I know we had a conversation around this a couple of days ago, in that you work with a lot of broker businesses in that model. And I think for a lot of our audience today, just for their own, we're not being selfish here, but for their own use, there could be some insights that you can provide us with.
Yeah, well, there's in broker businesses, there's obviously a value in what you've created.
Which is the trial book.
The client base and the trial book. And I think it's important to look at, well, what is that value? And then if you're looking to expand, to be using the value of what you have and what you've created to grow your business. And another example that we had was the particular client had a lifestyle goal about an asset. So they used their funds to buy that particular property and then refinanced and actually set up a separate facility for the broker business to actually then grow their business. So again, it's that delineation, the definition between what was the opportunity cost if I couldn't have bought that lifestyle asset, or would I have stayed married? versus, okay, let's look at the, you know, structure. It might have cost me just a little bit more, but I've got it, I've paid it off over a period of time, and I'm in a much better financial situation at the end of it.
And it's important to ask that question, like whether it's the broker or the accountant, to ask that question. What are your plans? Yes, you want to go and borrow money right now, but what are your plans in the next year, next 2 years? Because we need to structure this loan or structure this finance to ensure that we can get those goals and hit those goals as well. So it's really important to talk about that.
Now, being that today's session is really about unpacking and understanding what are the common funding traps for small business funding, as well as helping brokers identify where they can find some of these opportunities. Just out of left field, are there any particular industries where you see that there is a need for some, you know, some expert advice and some of the structuring that you'd see, Anthony, where, you know, typically it's a trend that you see across a particular industry or a particular product that's a business that needs some more help, I guess?
Look, I think without, it's hard to be specific there. I mean, some brokers specialise in a particular industry, but I think all industries have, if you look at it this way, all industries might have a specific need. So a retail industry might have a specific need coming into a certain season, or I got a client who's they make flippers and swimwear and stuff like that. So they've got a seasonality about their finance needs. You might have other businesses which are more capital intensive, so their finance needs are more about managing their terms of trade over time, where the payment terms might, like a larger manufacturing business or something like that, where they're trying to keep stock on the floor, their payment terms might be that they need some sort of facility in place to manage their terms of trade. So it's a little bit more industry by industry, I guess, in terms of the specifics around that. I've got a client which is a large freight firm.
Okay.
So they've got a number of different needs around, and so they do international trade. So there's foreign exchange needs, there's short-term cash flow needs, there's managing their, I guess, their terms of trade as well. So it can be a little bit more, I guess, sector by sector, but from a broker's perspective, a lot of it comes back to educating ourselves on, sure, we can specialise in particular sectors, and some brokers do, but it's really educating ourselves and understanding how to interpret the financial reports. And what I mean by that is understanding some of the key ratios. How do you interpret if there is a cash flow issue in a business, and how do you then provide a solution for that? Mm. How do you interpret and assist with, say, the growth trajectory, and what's the right finance to structure around that, and then educate ourselves on some of those solutions? Because it's not always just a term debt against an asset. There are a lot of other options to help businesses with those.
An example I can think of while you were talking is medical. So most of you out there have medical clients in a medical industry. They might be associated with a practice or something like that. So the first thing a broker does, I've seen in my experience, is go, well, a bank's going to lend a bit more because you have great cash flow, therefore we're going to go and encumber the house, even if it's for other investments or whatever else it might be. But I think sometimes you've got to sit back and look, especially with medical, and look at, well, if you've got strong cash flow and the funding for example, one I can think of is for expansion of the practice. Mm. Well, why don't we look at a specific facility for that practice rather than just going for the easy option
or fitting out the medical practice with practice, the dental chairs and all that stuff, which can be very expensive. Yeah. It's getting you can actually get specific asset finance around those type of industries.
I can see our panelists are eager with lots and lots and lots of examples to be using. But just a couple of things. I know we're very conscious of the time today. Poll three questions should be up on your screens now, so if you don't mind answering that for us. Before we obviously are also reminding our audience that there are some questions and we will be answering those shortly. But Alex, rumour has it that you have a big mystery magic ball that can foresee into the future of our industry, and you've actually got the power to predict the future. This superpower that apparently rumor states you have, and I guess something I found very interesting in our conversation is that one in four customers who have said that they would be very unsure that their business would still be viable or even trading had it not been for their Prosper loan. And looking at that, I think what I found is it's quite huge, that it's one in four. So where do you see, and I guess sharing some of your insights into some of the future market trends around the future of business funding, as well as I guess what advice you can give to brokers into tapping into some of those opportunities? Because it is huge. Yeah. One in four is quite big. So
I feel like I need a hat and a cloak and
the Harry Potter of the industry.
Talking it up.
We're not putting you on.
Now you've got to deliver. Come on.
You had me pressured by no lunch. So reciprocate the favour here.
I suppose, firstly, we're really proud of what we've achieved at Prosper, but and our referral partners have been a really big part of our success. Last year, we commissioned a paper trying to look at the economic impact. And the stat you called out there, that's where we found that the positive impact we're having on the economy is just enormous. Mm. That makes us really, really proud, and that should make our partners really, really proud. Stats that scare me, like 90% of small business failures are directly due to poor cash flow, to know that we've helped a lot of businesses who are still existing today because of us is really cool. But I know looking at the future and looking at, I mean, our credit decision engine that we've built looks at over 450 data points in 15 seconds. Now, I can't even decide what I'm going to have for lunch in 15 seconds.
That's from a female what to wear in 15 seconds, so, yeah.
So that's really cool. But when you look at what the capability is in technology today and things like artificial intelligence and customer behaviour and consumer demand. Right now I get frustrated, and I'm by no way, you know, the most tech-savvy guy in the world, but I get frustrated when my internet's low because I just have an expectation that information will be there immediately. So if I was to wind the clock forward and look at my crystal ball, I would say that consumers are going to expect us to know what they need before they even know it. Mm-hmm. Mm. So when I look at how complex it is in today's environment, just being aware of every single alternative option out there, I would say that's where referral partners and partnerships come into play, so that you can play to your strengths. Mm. So if you're a mortgage broker, then partner with a finance broker, partner with an accountant, partner, you know, make sure you surround yourself and you're resourceful. But education awareness and keeping a finger on the pulse as to what's going on in the market, because we were talking about cash flow forecasts. Well, they're going to expect us to know when they're about to have a problem and call them up and say, guess what? Here's your money. And they're like, what for? Well, you're about to have a problem.
So that's being sort of proactive versus the reactive, which is what we spoke about earlier as well. So, look, we've got a lot of questions flooding in from the audience. I know a lot of these a lot of them are quite similar in addressing some of the sort of same concerns. So I think the first one is really, I'm putting out this to Davey and to Justin. When is the best time for a self-employed or a small business owner, as we touched on, Alex, to separate their finances by creating trust funds for protection?
Size has something to do with it. So, you know, if you're a small business turning over $100,000 a year, it's way too early. But I think when a business gets to, and I saw a one yesterday, a sole trader online turning over $500,000 a year, to that particular person we're going to talk to. So generally speaking, it comes down to profitability and getting to a size where, you know, is it a $500,000 turnover? And then now, do I need to look at a trust and asset protection around that? And you do need to take advice around that because it's not a quick answer. Yeah. But
another point is also that the industry they're in as well. So if you're in the construction or building industry, it's a lot more risk. So therefore, it might be a good idea to separate your assets, your personal assets, or your investments from your business and having a trust fund as well.
I've got another question for you, Justin. How do you think brokers and accountants can best collaborate? And Davey, feel free to chime in. I know the two of you are working well here in tandem. So, you know, what are your insights around that?
Yeah, so from experience, it's about knowing, you know, if you're a broker, it's not about knowing one accountant and then working with that accountant. It's about knowing...
Which is typically the conception, isn't it? It's like kind of, you know, let's sort of pigeonhole ourselves with one accountant and let's work together.
I think it's a network. But, you know, you've got to have a network. And I know a lot of brokers. And whilst we have a broker that works in-house, you know, we're always talking and always talking about examples and ways in which we can help each other. And I think it's that diversity of people you're working with. And likewise, accountants, you know, you can't just say, well, I only know one broker, I'm just going to work with that broker, because sometimes the client mix and client fit doesn't necessarily end up at a similar level. Yeah. It could be...
And I know, Anthony, you've done this really well with accountants too. So what's your take on how brokers can actually work really well with accountants?
Yeah, I think there's two elements I think part of it is, all brokers have those referral networks through accountants and financial advisors and stuff like that. But in terms of the practicalities, part of it is educating the accountants around some of the different solutions and options, understanding how the accountants work with their clients. So some accountants are very much, I guess, looking in the rearview mirror. They're not really doing that more strategic work with their clients. But the accountants that are the good ones for the brokers to work with. They're sitting down with their clients. They're looking
like
at what's happening in the future. So from a broker's perspective, it's changing a little bit as well from maybe traditionally being a bit of an order taker saying, look, we want to get this facility in place, can you go and do it, to actually becoming more part of that consultancy team for the business where you're sitting around the table looking at their cash flow requirements, looking at their future needs with the accountant, with the small business owner, and working out more of a long-term strategic plan that you then go and execute as an agreed upon strategy. So it's taking a bit more of a strategic approach around the accountants that you partner with, as well as taking some time to educate them on some of the different options. And I've done that recently with an accountant I work closely with. We've sat down and talked about some of the different options. He only works with small businesses. And he said, I didn't realise we could maybe do that sort of thing. So it was a great conversation to educate them on some of the different ways they can help their clients.
Because they don't know what they don't know either, right? So
that's
it kind of goes both ways.
And I catch up with all my brokers on a regular basis as well. So it's not just brokers, accountants, and it's sometimes you just got to pick up the phone, give the broker a call, and, you know, if you don't get the right answer with this broker, speak to another broker and...
Second and third opinion. Now, one last question. I know we've only got a few minutes from the audience. Now, we've got a pretty interesting time. I mean, it's the last quarter of the year. Spring's upon us and we've got the holiday season coming up. Typically in small businesses, and I'm going to open this up to the whole panel, you know, and I guess maybe, Alex, I might start off with you, and then if these guys want to chime in, we've got a few seconds there. What are some common pressure points for small businesses leading up into the holiday season?
It's actually before that.
We'd be looking at it now?
Yeah, the answer is yes.
Okay.
So typically for the finance industry and certainly accountants, it's really busy leading into end of financial year and then post for you guys more so. Mm-hmm. For us, the busiest time of our calendar year, end of financial year is busy, but we are about to get into our busiest period. So our experience is that we were talking about retailers earlier. They got to start getting stocked up for Christmas. Restaurants, you know, getting extra staff in because festive season is around the corner. So that planning starts now, be it marketing, getting people to book your restaurants or God knows, kitchen manufacturers and installers, everyone wants their kitchen in by Christmas, you know. So all of a sudden they've got to, where they might do 3 kitchens a month, they've got to do 15 in one just to get their deadline. But what does that do for their business? So for us, that means talking to our finance partners and referral partners account to say, hey, when you're talking to your small business clients, make sure they're aware because this is what they're about to face.
Yes.
You've got that crystal ball.
Yeah.
You understand what industry they're in and make them aware that they've got options because they could still well be using Bank of Mum and Dad or credit card. You know, like it's where they've got options. So that's, I would implore everyone to just reach out and say, hey, you have options.
And there's two elements to that. There's how do you fund that seasonality in your growth and then how do you fund maybe a slowdown over that holiday season through. So they're different challenges, but you've got those two elements to it.
Mm-hmm. I tend to find that leading up to December, like to the 20th, it gets really, really busy for most industries. And then after, you know, Christmas, it starts slowing down. And sometimes it slows down to January. And even though it picks up in January, it doesn't mean the cash flow is coming in. Yeah. So the cash flow can come in until February to March. So they just need to make sure they have the right funding all the way to Feb or March.
And as brokers and accountants asking questions, you know, if you know your clients in retail and they've got a couple of different outlets and they've had a slow lead into December, well, then asking the questions about, well, what does that look like in January and February and how can we potentially look at some options to help you through that?
Well, panelists, you've been amazing. We're really almost out of time. So I'd like to, you know, thank you so much for joining us today. There are some more questions that we haven't had time to answer, but the Prosper team will come out to you directly with answers to those questions. Today's session has been recorded. So once our session is concluded today, you will receive a link to a recorded session. And overall, we hope you've enjoyed it. We hope you've been able to take away some key insights and we look forward to seeing you at our next educational event with Prosper. A huge thank you to our team and thank you so much.
Thanks, Nancy.
Thanks.
Thanks.
See you guys.
Bye.
See you.